special oversight hearing of the Assembly Committee on Environmental Safety and Toxic Materials. This meeting's now called to order. This morning, we're going to be reviewing the informal draft regulations for safer consumer products, also known as the informal draft green chemistry regulations, which were released by the Department of Toxic Substances Control on Halloween, October 31st. These regulations were required by AB 1879, which was authored by my esteemed colleague, Assemblymember Mike Fuhrer in 2008. Mr. Fuhrer is a member of this committee. He's unfortunate, has a conflict, so he's unable to attend. In that legislation, AB 1879, the legislature laid out the statutory foundation for the state's green chemistry program by requiring the Department of Toxic Substances Control, DTSC, to set up a robust regulatory process by January 2011 to first identify, then prioritize, and then evaluate chemicals of concerns and the products in which they are found. It also requires DTSC within that same time frame to adopt regulations that specify the range of appropriate actions necessary to reduce public and environmental exposure to chemicals of concern. It was landmark legislation which brought together the manufacturers and the environmental community, and something that we all should be proud of. Now we're, of course, 11 months past the statutory deadline, and we don't have a regulatory framework established for the green chemistry program. And this is an issue that I've expressed previously of grave concern to us and in the legislature. We did have a change of administration, and the governor appointed a new director of DTSC, who will be our first witness today, and also whom I have the utmost respect and confidence. And I'm pleased with the progress she has made in the months since she has been appointed. However, I cannot stress enough the absolute how absolutely critical it is that DTSD continues to work aggressively to get meaningful green chemistry regulations in place. I believe my role as the chair of this committee and the oversight responsibility requires that continual dialogue, and we've done that this year with the committee, and we're continuing it today. I believe that the green chemistry regulations have enormous implications for the future of California, for the future of the United States, and for the future of the world. They have the potential to drive much-needed information on chemical hazards into the market, the potential to steadily reduce the commercial and residential use of toxic substances, and the potential to create the market and regulatory conditions in California that are needed to spark investment in companies in the science of safer chemicals, safer products, and safer industrial processes. I have been heartened by the desire of all the parties to ensure that the California Green Chemistry Program works. Over the last year, I've met with dozens of business leaders, public health and environmental organizations, and community members, and we all want the same thing, a robust, scientifically sound regulatory process. None of us want single chemical ban bills. I'm of the opinion that this committee shouldn't be holding hearings on single chemical ban bills while we have this important process going on across the street at DTSC. And I've asked each and every person who's involved in this to focus their attention now on these draft regulations. Today, I've asked DTSC to provide an overview and summary of these informal draft green chemistry regulations and to describe the rationale that was used to develop them. This is an absolutely unique situation where we have informal draft regulations, so all the stakeholders can weigh in, and I applaud the director on this procedure that's come into an area of concern for all of us. I've also asked four members of the Green Ribbon Science Panel to testify today about their experience on the panel under the new administration and to provide feedback to us on the new draft regulations. Finally, I've invited some stakeholders in the process to fill us in on their view of the draft regulations. Please note that the members of the public will have an opportunity to testify on their views on the draft green chemistry regulations at the end of the hearing. I should also say that my staff and minority staff and members of here will be reviewing our program and schedule for the 2012 as this process goes on, when we're going to have continued hearings. Since the structure for regulatory action required in AB 1879 is broad and general, the legislature has, as I've spoken of, an elevated oversight obligation to ensure that both the letter of the law as well as the spirit is complied with. This oversight hearing is part of the California State Assembly's responsibility to ensure that agency authority is utilized in the most effective and efficient manner. This is the fifth oversight hearing this committee has held on green chemistry since the passage of AB 1879 in 2008. At this time, I'd like to offer Vice Chair of the Committee, Assemblymember Jeff Miller, the opportunity to make some opening remarks.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate the opportunity, and I will be very brief. I want to thank you for your leadership over the last year in your willingness to work with us and hold hearings on a variety of topics, including this follow-up one on green chemistry. And I appreciate the range of the agenda that you put together and allowing different folks from different perspectives and different industries to be able to share their ideas and thoughts. It's going to be interesting as we move forward next year, as we approach the time that we do receive the draft regulation, looking forward to working with all the stakeholders through that process and make sure that questions that are asked are appropriately being answered by the department and industry groups. And I'm looking forward to working with all sides of the equation to make sure that we get accurate information and the process is expedited as quick as possible, I guess, as they say. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Vice Chair. Ms. Assemblymember Nora Campos, also a member of the committee, your opening remarks.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. First of all, I want to also recognize you for your leadership.
I think we're on.
To recognize you for your leadership on this committee and for your commitment. I actually was a part of another oversight hearing, and I'm continually impressed by the fact that when you indulge into an oversight hearing, you take it very serious and thorough, and you bring the right players to the table to be able to give us the information we need as policymakers as we move forward. So I'm looking forward to what the presenters will be presenting today. And I think that in your opening remarks, you touched on various entities of what we need to see happen as we move forward with the green chemistry regulations. And I think this oversight is timely since we are less than a month away from January, and we'll be able to have the information hopefully in a timely manner that we need to be able to move this particular item forward in January as we move forward. So thank you.
Well, thank you. And with that, I'd like to call our first witness, Debbie Rafael, the director of DTSC. I'd like to congratulate you on getting out the proposed draft regulations and the comment period that you've provided to the stakeholders at this time. I've asked Director Rafael to provide an overview and summary of the informal draft green chemistry regulations and describe the rationale the department has and that they use to develop them. So, Ms. Rafael, excuse me.
Good morning. Yes, yeah. Good. I want to thank you, Mr. Chair and Mr. Vice Chair and Assemblymember Campos, for this opportunity, and especially, Mr. Chair, for bringing us all together. Several of your colleagues have commented on the impressive nature of the people who are going to be following me, and when I looked at the agenda that had been put forward by you and your staff, I was incredibly gratified and impressed that people are interested and committed along with us at DTSE to see this forward such that they're willing to come and share their time with us today. So I think today is going to be a very, very interesting couple of hours. So let's see. So I'm going to my presentation in the next 20 minutes or so is meant to touch on what you were talking about, some of the whys. So the why did we make certain policy calls in crafting this approach? AB 1879 was a law that had a tremendous amount of buy-in from different parties. It was fairly broad in its outlines, and so it was then incumbent on our department to interpret and implement those guidelines. And we talked a lot about, moving forward, these sort of three principles of practical, meaningful, and legally defensible. And everything, every decision that we made going forward in the last 11 months has been with that frame in mind. And to just summarize, what did 1879 do for us? The goal of that law was really to identify safer alternatives and then to avoid regrettable substitutes. Part of the problems people have been seeing when you identify a chemical in a product as a problem, everyone scurries to get rid of it, and then you could substitute it with something that might be, in fact, worse for the environment or for human health. So we needed to put this together in such a way that we would not, or we'd very much minimize that possibility. So the way I like to frame what 1879 did is that it's something actually quite radical in the sense of public policy, in that it's going to require that product manufacturers ask a different kind of question when they're looking at their design of their products. And that is the question, is it necessary? So 1879 is going to mandate that certain manufacturers ask the question, for example, is it necessary for me to make nail polish with formaldehyde? Is it necessary for me to make foam that contains brominated flame retardants? Is it necessary for me as a manufacturer to put nonylphenol ethoxylates in laundry detergent? Each of those are chemicals with unique problems that they present to human health and the environment, and yet they are perfectly legal to put inside of these kinds of consumer products. So what 1879 does is it mandates that manufacturers will have to step back and ask the question, is it necessary for me as a manufacturer to continue to make my product in that way? But what is truly innovative here is that an answer is not dictated. So the question is mandated, but the answer is going to be unique and up to the individual manufacturer. So that's what 1879 does. What we have done at DTSC is try and engage our stakeholders in the most meaningful way we can during this informal comment period. And so what we've published on Halloween is this 68-page full draft regulation, which is a lot for anyone to digest. And we realized that. And so as a way to very much engage a meaningful conversation with stakeholders, we also put out a 16-page summary so that people could engage in this discussion at any level they wanted. We also then put a then and now summary. How does this version of the regulations differ from previous versions? And we wanted to, instead of just having you have to look at two 60-page documents and try and figure out how they were different, we pulled out the key policy decisions and tried to make them as transparent as possible. We also created flowcharts and videos, again, as a way to engage as many people as we could in the conversation. And I'm going to end giving you some examples of how we've engaged. So here's an example of an overview graphic of what 1879 and these regulations do. Basically, what we're doing is a funneling down, where we start with the acknowledgement that there are tens of thousands, maybe 100,000, maybe not, but certainly tens of thousands of chemicals that are used in commerce. Not all of them are problematic. And so what we are doing is we are going to then, as the law dictates, create a chemicals of concern list from that larger universe. And then what we'll do is take those chemicals of concern and say, well, where are they in consumer products? And where are they in consumer products such that there is a problem to the environment or to human health? And given that universe of products that contain chemicals of concern, let's narrow it down even more and select what we're calling chemical product combinations that might be formaldehyde in nail polish, something formaldehyde in carpet adhesive, some lead in lipstick, something like that. And we'll look at those, and specifically those manufacturers will then ask the question, is it necessary? And the way they answer that question is by doing something called an alternatives assessment. An alternatives assessment will make sure that the answer to that question is robust and scientifically defensible and does not lead to regrettable substitutes. So that's the overview of what the regulations were trying to do. So how did we start to then set some policy parameters around each of those elements? So I'm going to go fairly high level here because that 68-page document would take far longer to go through. The chemicals of concern, the decision was made to do a fairly large list going out the door. And the way we're doing it is by combining a list of lists. This work has been done for years across the world of identifying chemicals of concern. So we're taking that work and putting it together and creating our list of lists, our list of chemicals of concern. We think there may be about 3,000 chemicals when we're done. There may be fewer than that. We're not 100% sure right now because we're doing some sieving of those lists. And then if we need to add or subtract from that list, there's a public process for that moving forward. So why did we choose to do this approach? This is important for people to understand what were we thinking. And the reasons for our thinking are not just because DTSC sat in a room and talked to each other. It's because we've actually had the advantage of talking to stakeholders for the last 3 years about this issue. So this decision was informed by hundreds of hours of conversation and hundreds of pages of comments from previous versions. So we believe this approach was important because, number one, it's consistent with the law. The law says very clearly to DTSC as the implementing agency, you need to take a look at what has been done. Don't reinvent the wheel. This issue has been looked at all across the world. Learn from it and use it. Number two, it focuses our limited resources on areas where work hasn't been done. So much work has been done on this chemical of concern list. Rather than us create a whole new process, we thought it was much more prudent in terms of resources to focus energy further down the line. The other criticism we heard was in terms of the implementation, that there was an urgency to get started and that if we had a very cumbersome process just to create a list, that wouldn't be the best use of time as well as resources. So it accelerates implementation. It also sends a signal to the marketplace. Here are a suite of chemicals that we would like you to pay attention to. Start asking the question. You're not mandated to do anything, but why don't you take a look and see what you use in your products? Very importantly for us, because this is a program that we're creating for the future, it's going to start small, but it's going to be around for a long time. And we want it to be a robust off-ramp for the legislature such that as new problems come up and come across your desks, you have a place to point them if you feel like the legislature is not the right place to handle problems. Sometimes it will be, sometimes it won't. We need a flexible palette so that as new problems arise in the future, that off-ramp is available to you and is available to the people of California. We believe that it deters regrettable substitutes. If we had a very small list, such as we've seen in Prop 65, although that's 800 chemicals, it may not seem small. It's small enough that what happens is people say, well, I'm just going to substitute. I just want to get off that list. And so they make decisions just to get off the list, not necessarily avoiding regrettable substitutions. And finally, because this process is as a result of many, many months of conversations, we looked around and said, well, what are other people doing for lists? And we found all sorts of examples of large companies and small companies wanting to be ahead of the curve and creating their own lists of chemicals of concern. And they seem to be at about this order of magnitude. So we felt that all of that together was a good basis for our decision. All right, so now we've gone from that light blue down to the dark blue. Now, how are we going to get to the purple? How are we going to now look at those chemicals of concern in products and then get to those red circles, which are the few product chemical combinations we're going to address? So we made a decision to do that in what's called a narrative standard. And the important point I want to make here is that people talk a lot about, is this hazard-based? Is it risk-based? What is this approach? Creating a chemicals of concern list is a very hazard-based approach. You're looking at the hazards of chemicals and putting them into a list. What we've done in terms of selecting our products is all about exposure. This idea of just because a chemical has a hazard doesn't mean necessarily there's a problem that we want to address today. Today we're going to address the problems where we know there's an exposure pathway, a serious potential for exposure. So we look at the adverse impact of the COC, of the chemical of concern, how dangerous is that hazard characteristic, and then quickly we go into, but so what? Is it in a product where you have an exposure potential, where we're worried about that chemical getting into people's bodies, getting into the environment, affecting people's health and the health of environment? So all these factors that come, potential exposure, market and household presence, who uses it and how do they use it, what happens at the end of life, all of those are exposure metrics where we're really heavily looking at the so what about each of these chemicals in products. We're also looking at, we were also instructed in the law to not have redundancy in terms of other laws, that would not be a prudent use of resources. So part of our prioritization and selecting our products is, are they already handled somewhere else? If they are in an equivalent way, then it would be redundant and not a good use of our resource to focus on them. So that is very much front and center in our prioritization, as well as, are there alternatives available? So our product chemical combinations, going to that purple, is really a very public process. All of those factors come in to play as we then put to the public, what are we thinking as potential candidates for those chemical product combinations? There will be a robust conversation once those candidates are selected. We expect that we will have that about 6 months after this is adopted. So because we have that list coming out, 6 months later, we will have then those potential chemical products that will be going through a public process that will be then an indication to businesses who's going to be asking the question, is it necessary? This narrative standard we feel is legally defensible, it's meaningful, and it's practical for us. So we feel that this approach allows us flexibility to so that we don't have to know going in what are going to be the biggest problems. And it's very hard for us to defend a very rigid approach to prioritization in terms of weighting and other methodologies, because it will depend on the product each time. And so we need that flexibility in order to make robust, defensible decisions. All right, so now we've selected our chemical products and we're thinking, realistically, it's going to be a handful. It'll be 2, 3, 4, maybe 5. I doubt it, frankly, because we don't have additional resources. It's going to be an opportunity for us to test the system. Once we have identified those products, then the alternatives assessment. And I'm not going to go into a lot of detail here, except to say that we talked a lot to the end users. Who are the people who would have to do this? It's companies. And we had many, many robust conversations with companies from a wide spectrum, from large to small. How would they do an alternatives assessment? And what do they need to see in a regulation to make sure it's practical? One of the things we heard is that they want it phased in. They want us to have an interaction with them over time to make sure they're doing the right thing so they don't waste their time. They need flexibility because some companies have tremendous experience doing alternatives assessment, and you will hear about that today. Some have never done it. So for some, we will give them strict guidance on how they do it. For others, they already know they need a flexibility of approach. In terms of timing, it depends how long will it take to do one. Well, that depends on how complicated the product is. So again, flexibility is important to our stakeholders here, and it's built into these regulations. The regulations set the standards, and the guidance will offer the details. So that means that the Green Ribbon Science Panel and our stakeholders will be very engaged in the future as we develop these guidance documents. But how do we know that they're any good? That answering the question, is it necessary, was done with integrity and was done with honesty? That's a difficult piece for us to solve in this regulatory arena, especially with our limited resources. So this is the approach that DTSE is taking, and we are in robust discussions right now if it's the right one or the best approach. But this is what we've got. Because we are only going to be doing 2 to 5 products starting out, we believe we can do audits with existing resources. So quality control at this early stage will happen with existing resources within DTSE staff. But in order to do that, we need to make sure that the quality of what comes into us is as good as possible. And in order to ensure that the quality of the submissions, we are going to create a certified assessor program is based on that LEED assessor program that's done for green buildings, where architects get certified that they know how to do a LEED assessment. We will then certify consultants, engineers, chemists, a wide range of potential people within companies and external to companies who will know how to do an alternatives assessment. And each AA will have a certified assessor signing off on its veritability. And finally, we will engage with the public as much as we can. One of the big concerns we heard over and over again from the companies who are doing alternatives assessments is they're worried about their trade secrets. They're worried about information that they wouldn't want to share. And we have not done anything radical at all in this regulation in terms of confidential business information. We are following very much California law, and we are giving companies abilities to claim that they need these things as confidential, and also a system for disagreeing with us if we disagree with them. So built into that, into these regulations, is very much consistent with California law on keeping things confidential.
Ms. Raffel,
yes.
Can I ask you a question about the certified assessor component of it? Is how do you see that? How does it fit into the framework? Would you have an audit that would trigger the assessment, or will you set up this team of assessors that maybe manufacturers would try to bring in on the early end? How do you envision?
It's more the latter. So we would have there will be a time gap because we're going to – so this will start in 2015. So the first AAs, alternative assessments, may not be done by certified assessors because we're going to need some ramp-up time to do that. But starting in 2015, a third-party organization who we will select – could be a university, could be a nonprofit, could be a for-profit. We haven't determined that yet. But a third-party entity will develop curriculum and training to certify people. And so a large company might say, well, we're going to get one of our staff certified. A small company may say, well, it doesn't pay for us to do that. If we are selected to do an AA, we'll hire that person. But every AA will need to be signed off by that. That won't be done on a case-by-case basis.
And this is only after they answer the question, is it necessary?
To help them answer it. So it's only those companies who are in those red dots, you know, those chemical product combinations. So it's only those companies. And that's a very important point.
Right. And it seems like it's a helpful tool for those small companies that may not have – they're saying, how are we going to do it?
Exactly.
Johnson & Johnson can do it.
Right. Exactly.
Can't do it.
Exactly.
Thanks.
And it's a way of making sure that improving the likelihood that what we get is good enough so that our auditing capacity is useful and not overburdened. So we see it – looking at that model in other entities, we see it as a potentially good model here.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, so winding down, this slide is simply a list of the regulatory responses that are put into the 1879 that DTSE has as a result of how that question is answered. So company says, you know what, it is not necessary for me to continue to put this chemical in my product. I'm going to phase it out, but I need 2 years to do it. So it could be no regulatory response at all is needed. It could be that the answer is, well, it is necessary and I need to keep using it. And then we have a suite of options depending on the impact of that decision. We could ask for notification of the public. We could ask for, we could restrict the sales and the use of that. There's a range, and each one of those is spelled out in the regulations as to when we might select that particular regulatory response. So what we think this has done is it sent signals to the marketplace very much by having a robust list that it's an opportunity for innovation. And the reason we believe this is true is because we are not, as government, dictating the answer. We're only mandating the question. And that is then the opportunity for innovation, to answer that question in a way that works the best for individual companies here in California. I wanted to spend a minute talking about how do we know we're on the right track. And to your comment, Vice Chair Miller, you said you wanted to make sure that we were listening to stakeholders, whether they be in industry or outside of industry. And I want to give you a sense of how we've been doing that. We started, we launched these at the very end of October. 2 weeks later, we had a meeting of our Green Ribbon Science Panel, where those members of the scientific community from across the country went very deep and extensive into the regulation and helped us with specific questions. We had a public workshop this week. We have this oversight hearing, and we have a public comment period. And during this public comment period, I just have in front of me just a list of, for 1 month, these are the meetings we're having. Sierra Club, Tech America, Change, Dell, American Coding Association, Global Automakers, Auto Alliance, HP, Apple, TechNet, Procter & Gamble, Green Chemistry Alliance, Sierra Club, Toy Industry Association, California Retailers. I mean, that's just 1 month of people we're meeting with. So I hope that at least gives you the confidence in us that we are casting a wide net of feedback as we go forward. So next steps, this is where the chair and I have some discussions about timing. So I put up here that it's February-ish that we're going to launch and fall-ish that we're going to adopt. I know that he is anxious for us, and I very much appreciate that, to do it faster. And so it will depend on how well we get it right in January, February, as to how long it will take in terms of comment periods and how many we need. So I want to manage expectations. I don't want to promise things that I can't deliver. We are working very hard on this right now, and everyone is got full attention to this. So sometimes it feels like a hurdles race, this process, but I do think there's a light at the end of the tunnel, and I want to thank you all for your commitment, because it is the commitment of oversight hearings like this that enable us to make sure everyone's at the table. So I appreciate that. And that's all my comments right now. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. When reviewing the October 31st draft, unlike the two previous versions of the draft regulations, it doesn't require responsible entities to provide chemical and product information during the prioritization process. Instead, the Department of Toxic Substance Control will request the information.
Yes.
So can you comment on how we're going to ensure that you receive the necessary information? I mean, there's a partnership that's going on, I believe.
You know, that's a great word for it, actually, because that's what it is. Instead of a command and control, it's a partnership. And the reason for that change goes into those three touchstones that I mentioned of practical, meaningful, and legally defensible. The legally defensible part, we were a bit concerned that we might not have the authority to require that information based on the statute. And so rather than take risks in our regulation, it was my decision as director to be fairly conservative in how we interpreted our authority under the statute to really minimize potential challenges once implementation was going forward. And so making that conservative decision meant that we sort of shifted into a partnership asking for information rather than requiring it. It is going to make it potentially challenging to go from, I want to go back to the, sorry, let me just go backwards. Let's see if we can do this quickly, probably not so quickly. I want to just show that graphic. So it will potentially make it challenging for us to go from that dark blue circle to the purple, because how do we know what chemicals are in products to begin with? And so that is going to be a challenge.
I know that we have some chemicals we have quite a bit of information about, and there's been alternative assessments also. But on the other end of the spectrum, there's some chemicals that we have very little or no information available, and there's you know, lots of new chemicals that are being developed daily. How will you deal with that?
Great question. And I would say that, again, if I go back to my touchstones and as sort of the thinking behind some decisions, the decision was made, again, on, I will take responsibility for this, to not require manufacturers to fill data gaps. So if there is little known about a chemical, this implementation does not require that those gaps get filled in the up until the regulatory response. So, and that was done with the word practical in mind. We heard from our stakeholders that one of the things they greatly feared, especially when you have so many chemicals of concern, that if they were going to have to fill every unknown data gap for so many chemicals, that the burden would be phenomenal. And our concern was not only that it would have financial impacts, but it would slow everything down tremendously. We wanted to be able to get to the end of this, get to a regulatory response. And so from a practical standpoint, the way we approached this problem, and I agree with you that it is a real challenge that I do not, and I don't think we solve it in this regulation. So it may be a challenge that needs to get solved in another format of data gaps and unknowns, is we said in the regulatory response that one of those responses may be that you need to go back and do some more testing about your alternative. If you're choosing an alternative for which we don't have enough information, perhaps, then we may say, okay, it appears to be better, so we appear not to have a regrettable substitute, but we don't have a lot of confidence in that. So we're going to ask you to fill some data gaps and get back to us so we can reevaluate.
Now, you've indicated that taking a limited approach, you have the resources.
Yeah.
And that's good news for all of us, because there's certain budgetary constraints that we have. Hopefully, you'll inform me or inform us if that becomes a challenge, or at what time as we get the framework set up.
Yes.
Because I guess the question is what will happen if the Department of Toxic Substance Controls isn't able to marshal the resources to complete the regulations or the operation of the program.
Yeah,
you believe you have enough to get us to September, right?
I believe that we have enough to get us to a couple of those red dots. But after that, you know, if we want to expand, if we want to do more robust approach and make this truly more meaningful, I'm not confident at that yet, and so I welcome the invitation to come back to you on that. And I promise you, I will. Allowed, yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Is it Director Rafael?
Rafael, like the city, San Rafael?
Rafael, thank you.
Thanks.
Nice to meet you. Sounds like you've come into the department and really taken the reins, and really appreciate you doing that. It's been a void that's we've had for some time. So my question is pertaining to, in viewing whether you're a large company or even some of the smaller companies, maybe some of the smaller companies that have tried to take advantage of some of the green incentives that the legislature and the state has provided to build their businesses, whether it's a cleaning chemical or cosmetics or something like that. I guess my question is twofold. How do you approach these companies, big and small? What's the method of communication? I mean, you had listed your outreach there to several companies this month, but I mean, how do you actually communicate and reach out to these companies, the large ones probably more in tune to what's going on than, say, the smaller ones, mom and pop businesses that maybe have, given up everything in their life to invest in these companies and they have their life savings in it, so they don't get caught off guard? And secondly, do you is there a philosophy or is there a plan to give these companies a indication of the costs associated with an alternatives assessment, a range, a help, advice, what it might do to their company if Plan A, Plan B, Plan C gets implemented? And so I don't know if you have the answers to that, but I'm probably more or less just trying to get your philosophy and your idea on how you would approach those two areas, communication and then costs.
And then help,
Yeah.
The communication piece is a challenge, and I have to say that it's because, as you yourself said, the larger companies are very well connected. So they're represented individually, and if you look at who we've met with, we meet with individual companies and trade associations. And so they've got a double connection with us that way. And the some of the smaller companies may not even be members of the trade associations, and so may not even be aware that this discussion is going on. The way we communicate is we try and communicate. We try and actually help ask the trade associations to help us, and many of them do because they have publications. Again, those would only be going to their members, and so that's a challenge. So from a philosophy standpoint, I think that there's two times to communicate, and I'm not sure when you're talking about. There's the development of the regulation, and then there's once your product has been named, where communication will be absolutely key. So our focus moving forward is going to be for the smaller ones very much when we identify a product, because then we'll be looking at who manufactures it and we'll know, is it a bunch of small mom and pops that may not have resources? Is it a suite of larger companies? And that will then inform our communication strategy to reach out. How much can we use the California Retailers Association or the Grocery Manufacturers Association, some of them that have many small and large members? Philosophically, they need to be at the table, because it turns out what the regulations do, once we name a product, at that point, we name two very important things. We talk about the de minimis, what it takes to get out of doing it, and secondly, the time frame. In order for us to name those, it's going to require that we've had conversations up front with people who make them. And so it'll be very important in terms of impacts to those smaller companies that they're having those conversations with us. And so we have a very strong commitment to reach out at that point in time. In terms of helping them with resources, I think that's a very valid concern. One of the things I have been doing recently, and we hope to make an announcement in January, is looking where we can get help ourselves for hand-holding for others. And I'm looking to the federal government on that. And EPA has said verbally, we haven't got a signed MOU yet, that they will give us resources and hand-holding. I'm hoping that that is money and people, not just you can ask questions, to actually offer assistance to those small companies, especially first time around when we're learning together how to do it. It's going to be very critical that we help those small companies.
Is that related to it, giving the companies information in terms of what the regulation or the alternative assessment might cost them?
Yeah, well, so what I'm hoping is to help them actually with that cost, because
I can
tell them, you know, that we think the average one is 50,000, 100,000, I don't know. You know, the cost of alternative assessment will also be determined on the complexity of the product that we select. What I hope to do is, if we've got some small companies involved, can we actually find them handholding resources to reduce that cost? So that's part of the discussion I'm having with EPA.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
To follow up on that, so we've got our products requiring the alternative assessment, and I'm looking at the nexus between that and the response, the agency response. Can you explain that a little bit? Is that going to go on at the end after they've done the assessment, or is it a continuous? A little gray.
It's hard to do without an answer. So when we ask them, is it necessary? We can't really look at regulatory response until we get an answer. However, there will be indications based on the products that we choose. If we choose a product where the exposure that we're worried about is taking place at the end of life, then chances are the regulatory response will be if you don't take it out, you need to take it back at the end of life. So there will be very much indications to the manufacturer what likely regulatory responses are. If it's a product that's used by children, it may in fact be that there's a notification to process that will need to happen if you don't take it out. So by reading the regulations of what those regulatory responses would be used at, there will be indications to companies. However, that suite of choices will be after, very much after we get an answer back and we understand the implications of their choice. If they choose something that is still a real problem for water quality, then we are going to have to choose a regulatory response to mitigate that. So that's why it is necessary that that nexus happens once they answer the question for us.
Hence the need for a close partnership with
Indeed.
Everyone.
Indeed.
Well, thank you for your time this morning. We'll be asking the Green Ribbon panel some of those same questions about that
Perfect.
Idea.
I appreciate it. Thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you. So now I'd like to move on to the next portion of the program and call up four members from the Green Ribbon Science panel that I've asked to be here today. We have Dr. Megan Schwartzman, Timothy Malloy, Dr. George Dalton, and Dr. Ann Blake. I'm sure most of folks are familiar that the Green Ribbon Science panel was required to be established by AB 18. Come forward and have a seat. By AB 1879. It is composed of experts who provide advice on scientific matters, chemical policy recommendations, and implementation strategies for the Green Chemistry Initiative. The panel will ensure that implementation efforts are based on strong scientific foundation. While the panel is not a consensus body, I have asked these four members to be here today because they come from diverse fields and backgrounds and can provide us with a sampling of feedback from experts in their field. So let's start with you, Dr. Schwartzman. Good morning.
Good morning. Is that all right? Am I close enough there?
I think it's on.
Sufficiently. Okay. Chairman Wachowski and Assemblymember Miller, thank you very much for the opportunity to be here today. Oh, Assemblymember Miller, there he is. My name is Megan Schwartzman. I'm a family physician and an environmental health scientist at the University of California, Berkeley, in the Centers for Occupational and Environmental Health. I'm also the Associate Director for Health and Environment in the Berkeley Center for Green Chemistry. And my involvement in green chemistry and chemicals policy began in 2007 when I co-authored with colleagues at UC Berkeley and UCLA, partly to my right here, a report commissioned by DTSC in which we examined the critical role of green chemistry in protecting public health, the state's economy, and our natural resources. In short, how to assure that the production of goods and services does not come at the expense of public health or the environment. The analysis in that report to DTSC built on an earlier report that was produced by our center and commissioned in 2004 by this committee, under the leadership of John Laird, and by the Senate Environmental Quality Committee under Chairperson Byron Scher. In 2009, I was appointed to the Green Ribbon Science Panel. I'm speaking today from this experience with California's Green Chemistry Initiative and from my knowledge as a physician and an environmental health scientist, but my comments are, of course, my own. They don't necessarily reflect the views of other members of the panel, the Berkeley Center for Green Chemistry, or the University of California. I'd like to address the committee on three topics. First, the Green Ribbon Science Panel's activities and its interactions with DTSC. Second, the current draft informal safer consumer products regulations. And third, the opportunities that the legislature, this committee, now has for advancing the Green Chemistry Initiative as a whole. So I'll begin by addressing the panel and its interactions with the department. That is the role of the panel. Over the past year, DTSC's charge to the panel and interactions with us have significantly improved our ability to contribute to the implementation process. The DTSC formed subcommittees, as I think you're aware, prior to the full panel meetings in May and July that generated concrete and detailed input for the department on two topics: how to identify and prioritize chemicals of concern, and how to structure an effective process for alternatives analyses. DTSC staff posed questions to the subcommittees, had us follow up with written input, and summarized the subcommittee discussions in the form of options that DTSC subsequently presented to the full panel for deliberation. with the caveat, as you mentioned, that the panel is not a consensus-based body. We don't vote. We're not tasked with developing a set of recommendations to formally submit to the department. I can say that I have experienced a sort of convergence of views during the panel's discussions. I think the discussions have helped the department get what it needs from the panel. Some of these changes probably reflect the natural progression of the regulation writing process. As the regulations are honed, the questions to the panel have gotten more specific, and the staff is better able to incorporate the feedback from the panel. But it also reflects an evolution in leadership. As Director Rafael has described to this committee, her staff, and also us on the panel, we've now have organizing principles to work with, that is, designing the program that is meaningful, practical, and legally defensible. She has solicited input also from DTSC's sister boards, departments, and offices within CalEPA, as well as the Department of Public Health. The conversations that she's been having with these BDOs and the Department of Public Health are a new phenomenon for DTSC in the Green Chemistry Initiative, and their positive influence is evident in these informal draft regulations. She's also the first director to actively participate in the entirety of a two-day panel meeting. In short, I can't speak more highly of the leadership of Director Rafael as she's provided in this process, first as co-chair of the panel and now in her position with the department. DTSC, as I think you're getting the sense, appears to have found its footing. I'd like to move now to discuss the current draft of the informal safer consumer product regulations that the department issued on Halloween. While I'll provide most of my substantive comments in writing to the director and her staff, I'd like to highlight a couple of issues for this committee. First, some key improvements that appear in this draft, followed by some of the changes that I think still need to be made for this program to succeed. Overall, the draft is notable for its clarity and its internal consistency. Where previous proposals were complex without, I think, being any more effective for that complexity, the present draft outlines a discrete process, providing clear deadlines and a reasonably expedient timeline. This is essential for the businesses who will need to interpret these regulatory requirements and who depend on the predictability of the process for their businesses. Specifically, these draft regulations have new elements that make the program more scientifically rational and defensible. These include, as Director Rafael mentioned, the robust list of chemicals of concern, and also this critical addition to the process of alternatives analyses, that for hazardous chemicals in products, businesses will be asked to look beyond the question of can it sell or is it legal, and ask, is it necessary? And in illustrating this, I actually picked some of the same examples that Director Rafael outlined. Is it necessary to have nonylphenol ethoxylates whose degradants are linked to sex changes in fish in laundry detergent that's designed to go down the drain? Is it necessary to have perchloroethylene, that's a Prop 65 carcinogen, in the clothes that come back from the dry cleaner? Not to mention the consequences for the workers who spend 10 hours a day around those substances. Is it necessary to have endocrine-disrupting chemicals in furniture, IV bags, electronics, cash register receipts, shower curtains? How about formaldehyde-releasing chemicals in baby shampoo? This is different than asking if shampoo is necessary, or furniture, or electronics, or clean clothes. It simply asks whether we need to rely on hazardous chemicals to do those jobs, or whether our businesses are innovative enough to make those products safe. Safe for consumers, for the environment, and for the workers who produce those goods and services on which our society depends. Other improvements in this draft include the provision that enables the department to consider aggregate exposure to a chemical that comes from multiple different sources, as well as the cumulative effects on health from exposure to different chemicals that nevertheless act on the same organ system or that have similar health effects. In fact, this is the most scientifically valid, or maybe the only scientifically valid, way to address the issues of chemical exposure and risk. To turn to some of the important changes to this draft that are still needed, Some of the overarching limitations arise from systematic issues, such as the lack of data requirements that you called out, and the state's trade secrecy laws that Director Rafel referred to. These issues, I believe, are in the legislature's reach, and I'll discuss them in a moment. But other changes are within the department's reach, and if made, they could help align the industry's economic interests with the goals of this regulation. So some of these changes that are within the department's reach include, number one, on the dispute process, there's proposed dispute provisions that, as currently written, would permit companies to put all regulatory actions on hold while they dispute any action DTSC takes under the regulations. So these actions could include the listing of a chemical of concern or the identifying of a priority product, and that needs to be revised. Number two, on criteria for selecting safer alternatives, in this draft, companies could disqualify a safer alternative that they deem to be less competitive economically than the existing chemical. Creating a phase-in period would instead provide the time during which safer alternatives are brought to scale and therefore become economically feasible. It's too high a bar to ask that any alternative that's not widely used currently is on a par economically with the existing product.
Couldn't that be remedied with the regulatory response that DTSC made?
Except that a regulatory response has to follow the completion of an alternatives analysis. So if the alternatives...
The game gets delayed too long.
Exactly. If the alternatives analysis gets disputed, then everything is put on held until that dispute is resolved. As they're currently written, I think this is revisable. Number three, regarding the accountability in the alternatives analysis process, this is what Director Rafel discussed in the plan for the training and certification program. But I think that a peer review process added following the completion of an alternatives analysis would improve the proposed method for ensuring the quality of these alternative analyses that companies submit. And we have some models for doing this. The UC system already provides that kind of peer review for regulations proposed by CalEPA. So there, and that would have to be tweaked for this purpose, but there are some models like that. So for each of these points and several others, including some critical things such as insufficient protection of workers in the current draft, I'll be submitting detailed comments to the department along with the regulatory alternatives that I envision. Overall, though, the program that DTSC has proposed is getting much closer to the best that can be done under the AB 1879 statute. Addressing the issues I've raised here and a few others, will move us closer to a regulatory program that supports the growth of a sustainable business sector, one that contributes to the health and well-being of all Californians and our environment. With some fixes, this program could succeed in word. But for it to succeed in deed, the department needs your legislative support. Which brings me to my final topic, opportunities that the legislature, this committee, now has to fulfill the promise of the GCI, the Green Chemistry Initiative, as a whole by strengthening DTSC's hand and by advancing the other planks of the GCI that will together create a more comprehensive chemicals policy. DTSC, and really the state of California, needs three things from the legislature. First, sufficient resources to implement this ambitious program. Second, the authority to collect data from chemical producers and product manufacturers, and third, addressing problems with the state's trade secrecy laws. Because of these additional needs, there's a fourth: backup from the legislature in the form of ongoing oversight of hazardous chemicals, which I know is slightly distasteful to this committee, but I'll try to convince you why it's necessary. I'll address each of these in turn. First, on resources. The AB 1879 statute granted the department the authority to create a broad, far-reaching program, and the bill's authors, and I would say the world at large, are expecting something grand. And yet, what the department can accomplish, as I think you've heard very clearly from Director Fell, with its current resources, may not live up to these expectations. In fact, some of the shortcomings I see with the proposed program are the direct result of DTSC anticipating the need to operate a program within its statutory and financial limits. It's therefore built in some self-implementing elements and other creative workarounds that nevertheless risk reducing the program's ultimate impact. And I realize that the current economic climate makes this plea for funding a difficult ask, but in the long term, no matter how good the final regulations may be, it will be difficult to create a program that fulfills the scope provided for by the statute without additional resources. The second logical place for additional legislative action, and this was the point you raised, Chair Wachowski, is in the area of data collection. The size of data gaps in publicly available information on chemicals in products, how they're used, and their hazardous properties has been widely described as one of the largest barriers to effective regulation and the greening of the chemical enterprise. And yet, as the director noted, there's no authority within AB 1879 or insufficiently clear authority for DTSC to require companies to routinely submit chemical information. There's a tremendous demand for this kind of transparency, though. The public wants to know what they're buying. Retailers want to know what they're selling. Manufacturers want to know what's in the components they purchase. Company shareholders want assurances that their investments aren't in jeopardy. And investors want to know where to put their capital. While some companies with large market share, and I think we'll hear from two of them today, are able to obtain ingredient information from their suppliers, little of this information is available to regulators and much less to the public. Hazard and use data are even harder to come by. So granting DTSC the authority to request this basic information would greatly improve the department's ability to make accurate decisions on chemical prioritization and to efficiently identify the safer alternatives based on a much more complete picture of the science than they'll otherwise have. Completing these tasks without the authority to require product manufacturers to submit that information creates inefficiencies and challenges that the department shouldn't have to surmount. Meanwhile, DTSC has devised some creative approaches that I think you heard from the director, but their success depends primarily on companies stepping forward to do the right thing. And that brings me to the third area that lends itself to legislative action, the potential that the state's trade secrecy laws could produce extensive claims of confidential business information, claims that extend beyond legitimate protections for the early adopters of safer technologies, who we want to incentivize, to ones that effectively shield from public view the identity of hazardous substances, their alternatives, and even potentially the methods used to make that determination of which is safer. Addressing the issues posed by the state's trade secrecy laws as they apply to this program could be a useful topic for future panel subcommittees, but it'll also require action from the legislature. These three issues, slim resources, the lack of statutory authority on data requirements, and the prospect of extensive trade secrecy claims, mean that the program's success will depend on the goodwill and honest efforts of the regulated industry, of something akin to a voluntary program. This could work in only two cases. Either the regulated community is altruistic and sees the overall good and need for the program, or the program's requirements create the market conditions, as you discussed, that align industry's economic interests with the regulatory goal of an economy built on safer, more sustainable products. Some industry leaders are already doing the right thing, motivated by an ethic of social responsibility and by new norms created by dramatic policy changes in the European Union. Others, however, are heavily invested in maintaining the status quo, and in the middle, there's probably a large body of businesses awaiting the signals that will point them in either direction. While we want to tap into the new expectations for industry's product stewardship, it may not be prudent to depend on them. We may not have the same good fortune or sufficient charm to do as Blanche DuBois did in Streetcar Named Desire, when she said, "I've always relied on the kindness of strangers." Finally, given the limitations I've discussed, the legislature must not cede all action on chemicals and products to DTSC. And this is where I hope you might be convinced in a different direction. So cognizant of resource constraints and aiming to phase in the new program to work out the wrinkles, the department projects, as you heard, that this program will be able to identify only 2 to maximum of 5 priority products in the first year and maybe as many each subsequent year. With 74 billion pounds, that's billion, 74 billion pounds of chemicals produced or imported into the U.S. every single day, and 23,000 different individual chemicals identified by Canada as requiring further investigation or action, the legislature will have to consider additional legislation focused on chemicals of concern in products, in workplaces, and the environment. We should acknowledge that the Safer Consumer Products Regulation will not on its own comprise a comprehensive chemicals policy that the state needs. As we've noted, such a complex and overdue and long overdue undertaking will require a multi-pronged approach. And both the legislature and the administrations should resist the temptation to declare that DTSC and the Green Chemistry Initiative have it all wrapped up. In conclusion, to wrap up myself, since this committee's last oversight hearing on the GCI, DTSC has hit its stride. A dedicated internal team of staff has improved the proposed regulations with each iteration. This year's process of creating subcommittees has made the panel's input to the department more relevant, and the department has, in turn, been increasingly responsive to that input. The University of California's reports to the legislature and to DTSC have concluded that to create a sustainable future, California's industrial development will have to solve, not exacerbate, existing health and environmental problems. That's, of course, an enormous challenge, but if DTSC can produce a strong set of smart regulations and with the support of this legislature, California could very well put the state on the path to meeting this critical objective. As both the legislature and DTSC proceed with implementation of the GCI's 6 planks over the coming years, I offer the resources of the Berkeley Center for Green Chemistry and my own personal commitment to the panel. I thank you for your ongoing support of this effort in California and for the opportunity to testify here today.
Thank you, Doctor. Next, we'll hear from Professor Malloy from UCLA.
I guess I wouldn't be a college professor if I didn't have PowerPoints, right? So, good morning, Chair, Vice Chair, and staff. I want to first start by thanking you for inviting me here this morning to participate in this oversight hearing. My name is Timothy Malloy. I'm a professor of law at UCLA School of Law, where I teach environmental regulation and policy, with particular emphasis on regulatory design and the ways in which businesses respond to regulation. I'm also one of 2 faculty directors of the UCLA Sustainable Technology and Policy Program, which is an interdisciplinary program focused on advancing regulatory policy and the deployment of sustainable technologies. And it's interdisciplinary in that it brings both law and policy together with science and public health issues. I want to point out in speaking today that I'm speaking in my own individual capacity, and obviously my views don't reflect those of the university, the School of Law, STPP, or the Green Ribbon Science Panel. And I also want to just tell you a little bit more about my background because I think it's relevant to the kinds of conversations that folks are having with respect to these regulations. Prior to working at UCLA, I was, I guess you could say, on both sides of the fence. I worked at EPA as an enforcement attorney under a number of regulatory programs involving chemicals, both chemical emissions and pollution, but also the approval of the use of various chemicals under the federal chemical policies, the Toxic Substances Control Act, or TSCA. I also spent 6 years representing private companies, both very large chemical plants and very small mom-and-pop operations. So I think that experience has kind of helped me when I think about regulatory design and trying to establish a balanced program that both reaches the goals of the regulation, but at the same time takes into account the necessary constraints that businesses operate under in the real world. With that in mind, I guess I would echo the comments of others that AB 1879 is clearly a watershed in chemical policy regulation. It was intended to be scientific, systematic, and establish a transparent process. While other programs, most notably the Toxic Use Reduction Act in Massachusetts, have elements that require the comparison of chemicals with other potentially safer alternatives, California is largely unique in that it has taken that to the next step. It's not simply a planning statute. It has coupled alternatives analysis with regulatory response, and that is something very, very special. The question that I would like to address today is whether the program envisioned under the informal draft regulations is likely to achieve the remarkable vision that's reflected in AB 1879. So let me begin by observing that as a general matter, I think the informal draft regulations are a substantial improvement over the prior informal drafts and straw man proposals and the formal regulation, formal draft. They set out a fairly straightforward process that I think is responsive to many of the concerns raised by stakeholders, including the members of the Green Ribbon Science Panel. And while one may not agree with all the positions that have been adopted by the agency in this informal draft, and I count myself as one of those, it is clear that the informal draft represents considerable thought, careful drafting, and sustained commitment. And moreover, as a member of the Green Ribbon Science Panel, I'd like to note that I believe agency staff and management have made extraordinary efforts to ensure that they made effective and efficient use of the panel. Now, that said, and despite the agency's significant efforts here, there are several aspects of the draft regulations and the nascent program itself more generally that I fear could undermine the effective implementation of this program. Two of these concerns are rooted in the limitations of the statute itself, while the third lies more directly with choices made by the agency in implementing the program. Now, I aim to do more than just point out problems. So for each of these concerns that I raise, I'll attempt to identify one or more recommendations. My first concern deals with data generation and collection authority, something that's been addressed by prior speakers. Without a doubt, having reliable information, not only about the hazards associated with particular chemicals, but the exposures that may occur, the exposure pathways and so on, are central to policy formulation and implementation. So we really have two aspects of information that are important here. One is the generation of the information, right? How do we fill those gaps that exist? And the second is the collection of that information. How do we get that information into a system by which stakeholders and the agency are able to have that information and use it in making decisions? What I've put up here, and this also appears in on the last page of my written testimony, essentially is a just a very simple flow chart of what the draft regulations envision happening under the AB 1879 process. So on the left-hand side there, the first step is that, as Director Raphael pointed out, the first thing is DTSC is going to have to identify chemicals of concern. And from the draft, it appears that there will be roughly 3,000 or so chemical concern identified. Now, that's going to be, once that is done, and that appears to be a fairly effective process that's developed, to use existing lists, to compare them, to sieve them, to have interaction with stakeholders, and then end up with a set of chemicals, appears to be very effective. But the next step, then, is to take that list and to identify product chemical combinations in which those chemicals are used in California. Now, this is the first spot in which there will be enormous information demands. The first part of this, of course, is that if we have 3,000 chemicals, and then we think about all the products that are in commerce in California, it doesn't take too long to identify that there could be tens of thousands of product chemical combinations that have to be considered as part of the prioritization process. This is compounded by the fact that the location of that particular information, even where it exists, is very diffuse in the marketplace. So the manufacturer of a particular formulated product, such as a house cleaner, or the manufacturer of a assembled product, such as consumer electronics, may not actually have the information about what is in their particular product. That information may be several steps up the supply chain in various suppliers and components. So that's a very, very substantial issue of collection of information. It's further compounded by the fact, as has been pointed out, that some of the information determined in terms of what is in a product and what are the hazards associated with the chemical is also not available. And that takes us to the next step. Once we have identified all the product chemical combinations in commerce in California, it will be necessary to prioritize them using a number of factors that have been identified. Now, stop for a moment and think about the range of information that is necessary for this. First, we have to be able to identify the various uses and exposures that may flow from the use of a particular product chemical combination. That requires us to understand how those products are used by particular consumers, and also to think how the product is produced and how the product is disposed of following use. So in order to identify implement the prioritization scheme that's identified in the draft regulation, there's also a need for an extensive amount of information. And then lastly, in performing and reviewing the alternatives analysis, both individual manufacturers, the agency itself, and stakeholders will also need access to a tremendous amount of information. The issue that I see with the way the regulations are drafted right now is that there is no authority explicit in the statute for DTSC to require the generation of this information by any party or the submission of that information. In fact, the only regulatory authority that's set forth in AB 1879 is set forth well down the process as part of the regulatory response. And at that point, it's far too late to provide the information that's required at these earlier steps. Now, to be fair, DTSC also has other information collection and generation authorities outside of AB 1879, most notably AB 289. Under AB 289, the DTSC has the authority to require manufacturers to submit particular types of information with respect to chemicals that are used in California. There are significant limitations, however, in the scope of the information that may be available in AB 289. That has not, in other contexts, however, stopped DTSC from deploying that authority in a very broad way to attempt to obtain from manufacturers information related to the ultimate use of particular chemicals. And the clearest example of this was the initiative started by DTSC to collect information on manufacture and ultimate use of nanomaterials, in particular carbon nanotubes. In the informal draft regulations, DTSC, recognizing the potential limitation on their data collection and data generation authority, incorporated a creative, elegant approach to encourage voluntary submission of information by consumer product and chemical manufacturers, importers, and retailers. In Section 69501.5 of the draft regulations, DTSC is required to seek information by requesting it from those entities. Now, should a company refuse DTSC's request, the agency is required to identify that recalcitrant party on what is known as its failure to respond list on the agency's website. This shaming approach is clearly designed to pressure companies to provide information voluntarily or to face the potential negative reputational impacts associated with being branded non-cooperative. While the protection of reputation clearly plays some role in business behavior, all the empirical work that's been done in the business administration area and in the environmental policy area indicates that this is a very uncertain driver of behavior and is highly contextual. And in a context in which it is likely that many, many manufacturers will be subject to information requests under the program, there's quite a bit of noise created in the marketplace and a difficulty for stakeholders such as NGOs or individual consumers to identify what they might view as so-called bad actors and to apply pressure to those companies to respond to the agency. I have two recommendations as how to deal with the paucity of information collection and data generation authority. One is I would recommend to the agency that while legal defensibility is certainly a key element of a regulatory program, in this particular case, I think they may have ceded their authority too easily. The regulations, I believe, ought to be changed so as to incorporate a more aggressive view of the authority under AB 289 and to assert the authority to require submission of information using that authority. However, I do believe that at the legislative level, there will be a need for action here as well. I believe that there should be a revision to AB 1879, to AB 289, or to both, to provide DTSC with clear, adequate authority to call in the relevant information, including data regarding the distribution and use of chemicals in products, as well as existing health and safety data. The revision should address the issue of data that's not only in the possession or control of chemical manufacturers, but should extend to all entities and individuals having relevant information, for example, use and exposure information held by distributors or by commercial end users. The legislation should also provide DTSC with express authority, where appropriate, to require health and safety testing. Alternatively, or as a supplement to this authority, the statute could provide for a government testing program, perhaps akin to the activities of the National Toxicology Program at the federal level.
Professor?
Yes.
I'm of the mind on this carrot and stick dilemma that, you know, we have this unique draft proposal. We know that we're going to have a comment period. I've stated and will continue to state that I want cooperation. I want people to go in. I like this idea of having early adapters. And there's, when I look at this, there's a continuum. There's people all over. Hopefully there's not, the bad actors will go back to their board and say, okay, this is the safe products we want to go. On the timing, I mean, I'm of the mind to let this play out. I've ambitiously said I want these things done in July. And the director and I are going back and forth on that with the limited resources. In your mind, you've identified this the legislative or possibility of legislative challenge. I'm thinking I should let it play out and see if there is a lack of exchange or lack of cooperation. Then maybe we need a legislative fix. I think it's a little premature. Tell me why I'm wrong about that.
Well, when I think about the options that you face, it's a question of as compared to what. So, for example, I think it's certainly reasonable to say, well, we should wait and see if there is cooperation or there isn't cooperation. With respect to the companies that will comply voluntarily to information requests, incorporating a requirement to submit information is unlikely to change that behavior. So I don't think that either taking an aggressive position in the regulations, asserting that authority, or taking the step of creating legislative authority now will change the behavior of those particular companies. So I think there's little downside associated there. So the question is there a downside associated with waiting? And I think with respect to the early phases of the legislation, I think there is because of the need to identify product chemical combinations and to prioritize those. If the department is going to use the factors that are set forth in the regulation in a good faith manner, which I have no reason to expect they will not, to cull through all the various product chemical combinations that are out there, to identify the three or four that make the most sense for getting the program off to a good start, they're going to need the information authority earlier on in that program. So the downside, I think, of not taking a more aggressive stance with respect to information collection and data is a lost opportunity. It may be that we will end up, when we get to that first set of two to four product chemical combinations, that the prioritization process itself has already been subverted. So I think that's one. But certainly, delaying, stopping, and seeing what the response is likely to be is not an unreasonable approach to take. But I think in the long run, and of course, we're all basing things on our perspective and our individual experience. Having been on both ends of it, representing companies who are subject to voluntary submission requirements, seeing what has happened at both the state level and the federal level where there were voluntary programs for the submission of information. And one example of this would be the efforts that EPA undertook under TSCA to develop more information about chemicals that are currently in commerce in the U.S., both conventional chemicals and nanomaterials. Both of those programs were, I think it would be fair to say, abject failures in terms of generating a significant amount of voluntarily submitted information. So the history of these types of voluntary programs, I think, speaks very strongly to the point that it's unlikely that you will see significant participation by the broad swath of companies. Certainly, you're going to get participation from the companies, the larger ones in particular, that are engaged in the process. However, to rely just on those, I think, runs the risk of skewing the early part of the prioritization process. And certainly when this program is rolled out in a more comprehensive point, once we get past the early stages, I think having that authority is going to be absolutely essential. The next point I'd like to address is resource constraints. Now, a regulatory program is only as robust as its funding source. Thus, even a carefully crafted protective statute can be substantially undercut by underfunding. In programs that face extensive procedural hurdles, similarly to what we see here, the effect of underfunding is exacerbated. And the story of the Federal Toxic Substances Control Act is illustrative here. That program was underfunded and understaffed and was unable to keep pace with the challenges facing it. In fact, one of the reasons that we see states like California taking a stand with respect to the review and approval of chemicals is because of the very failure of that TSCA program at the federal level. The lesson from TSCA is that you get what you pay for. Congress handed EPA a massive job of prioritizing, testing, evaluating, and regulating thousands of chemicals. That sounds fairly familiar. That's what AB 1879 does with DTSC. Yet neither the TSCA legislation nor the administrations that implemented it ever established an adequate, stable funding source for that enormous undertaking. And not surprisingly, that federal program languished. I believe that AB 1879 faces a similar fate. Like TSCA, it presents the implementing agency with a challenge of, I think it's fair to say, heroic proportions, but no additional resources. Now, let me say, the agency, I think, has made an admirable attempt to craft the best program it can, given those constraints. But as I'll discuss in a moment, the result is a program that leaves excessive discretion to the regulated entities. In other words, the limited resources available to the agency, I believe, will functionally transform AB 1879 into a voluntary program. During the development of this legislation, the Senate Environmental Committee analyzed the bill and focused on this resource issue. And as I note up here, they noted that if the state is to provide the necessary wherewithal to provide a genuinely comprehensive program, it is probably inescapable that future legislation needs to more fully consider a fee-based program. I believe that time has come. There are two primary options, I believe, that are available to address the issue of resource constraints. The first one directly increases the revenue available to DTSC through new fees. The second relies upon the market to provide third-party oversight of the regulated companies, oversight that DTSC would have provided had it had adequate resources. So let me first address the notion of permitting fees. And as prior speakers have noted, I know this is a sensitive issue, particularly given the fiscal constraints that the state of California faces and the economic conditions that businesses face. However, I believe that the legislature could establish stable funding for AB 1879 by mandating the collection of reasonable proportionate fees from the businesses regulated under the program, sufficient to cover the reasonable operating expenses of this program. Many examples of such fees are already on the books and are operating effectively, including air quality permitting programs and water rights permitting programs. Clearly, the difficulty of enacting such a funding mechanism depends on how it is characterized under Article 8A of the California Constitution, which we more commonly know as Proposition 13 and now, of course, Proposition 26. Section 3 of that article requires that taxes and fees must be approved by a supermajority in the legislature, with the exception of, among other things, charges that are imposed for the reasonable regulatory cost to the state incident to the issuing of licenses and permits. Fees designed to recover the cost of permitting programs may be approved by a simple majority of the legislature. So is AB 1879 a permitting statute? Permitting is a form of regulation in which an individual business receives governmental approval to engage in a specific activity subject to certain conditions that are set forth in that approval. So examples of permitting includes permits to construct a new air emission source or registration of new pesticides. We can contrast permitting to generally applicable rules that are imposed en masse on an entire population of businesses engaged in similar activities. Now, although AB 1879 explicitly, by its own terms, never mentions the word permitting or licensing, the statute and the informal draft regulations essentially describe a permitting process. Individual manufacturers, importers, or retailers of specific commercial products, consumer products, are required to submit an alternatives analysis and a recommended regulatory response. That is the quintessential permit application that we see in all of these other programs. DTSC is to review those materials and issue an individualized regulatory response that may ban or phase out the use of that product or may establish conditions for its continued sale in California. This is a permitting program, and it will, no doubt, impose significant regulatory costs upon DTSC. Now, obviously, if there were legislation to establish authority for a permitting fee schedule established by DTSC, that would have to be reasonably related to the cost of the programs. It would have to be fair in terms of the proportionality of the size of the fees. And it certainly would have to take into account the impacts on small business. There are clearly significant logistical and fairness issues that would have to be addressed in a fee schedule scheme. However, based on the experience from other programs, both at the state and federal level, I believe that those types of logistical and fairness concerns can be addressed through careful implementation. There's a second approach, what I call a market-based approach to oversight. In the event that stable funding isn't achievable, significant portions of the resource-intensive oversight function that DTSC would otherwise serve could be shifted to the marketplace, that is, to private oversight providers. Dr. Schwartzman has already talked about one approach similar to this, which would be peer review through academic institutions or nonprofits. Another approach may be review through independent third-party certified assessors. This would be different than the certified assessor program that exists in the regulations right now, in which that particular party, that assessor, is actually performing the alternatives analysis for the regulated entity. What I'm proposing here is a third-party independent review of an alternatives analysis that has already been prepared to assure that the quality of the alternative analysis is there, and to provide the results of that review to DTSC, thereby limiting the scope of resources that are required to be used by DTSC. Now, clearly, third-party oversight model that I've discussed here raises serious concerns regarding the independence of the third party, as well as implementation issues regarding certification and development of sufficiently clear objective standards that are fair to the individual business. While it is therefore not the optimal solution to the resource issue, and it raises political acceptability issues of its own, clearly, it does provide significantly more transparency and accountability than a self-executing model that exists in the regulations as they are written, in which individual businesses perform analysis and evaluation without any substantial agency oversight, which is the next issue I'd like to address. As I noted, the informal draft regulation set out a detailed process, including provisions for the submission and review of an alternatives analysis work plan, a final alternatives analysis report, and recommended regulatory responses. As part of these provisions, the draft regulations identify the factors that need to be considered by the regulated business in assessing and comparing alternatives. Most of these factors, such as health impact, environmental and ecological impacts, technical feasibility, and economic impacts, are clearly rooted in the statute. Yet despite this thoughtful attention to process, the informal draft regulations lack substantive standards to guide two central decisions. First, whether a safer, viable alternative does exist, and second, what the appropriate regulatory response ought to be. This lack of substantive standards is particularly troublesome here because the draft regulations provide the regulated businesses with extraordinary discretion. For example, Section 69505 directs businesses to, quote, use available quantitative information, supplemented by available qualitative information of analysis, to evaluate and compare the priority product and each of its alternatives. The next section simply states that the business shall select the alternative based upon that comparative analysis. Now, while DTSC does retain the authority to review the report and to engage in auditing, that review appears to be limited to simply determining whether the report is, quote, in compliance, unquote, with the regulations. Yet the regulations are process-based, and they lack any substantive standards. Therefore, the DTSC compliance review will not reach the substance of those decisions.
So, Professor, your concern is that when you do, if the manufacturer does an alternative assessment, let's say that certified assessor is in there too, and they have three alternatives, and A, B, and C may be the safer product, that clearly, but if they choose A and they say, well, we've made it safer than it was, then we're not getting, I guess, the most bang for our buck. Is that essentially your concern, or did I miss the point?
There's two concerns rooted in that. You've identified kind of the practical functional concern, which is you may end up with decisions that don't capture the goals of the statute itself, or which are not don't provide the biggest bang for the buck. And by that, I think you and I are both talking about
robust
public health and also fairness to other businesses and so on. Like all the factors that we think about when we think about fair, reasonable, and effective regulation. But what I'd like to stress here, this goes to the very core of what AB 1879 was attempting to do. AB 1879 is a regulatory program, and its goal is to protect public health while giving fair and reasonable support to economic concerns as well, right? But at the end of the day, we are attempting to reach a decision that is best for the public welfare as a whole. Those kinds of decisions, what is best for the public as a whole, should not rest in any individual business. No matter how much we may respect an individual company, and I've represented individual companies, I've worked with people on the Green Ribbon Science Panel for whom I have the highest respect, and in fact, if they were the people who were making all the decisions on alternatives analysis, I might be very happy to say, that's fine, I trust them. But in the real world, we know that decisions are going to be made by a broad swath of people. Some of them will be driven by a fair balancing of both private and public concern, but others may not give the weight to the public concern that is embedded in AB 1879. If I can give you a particular example, if you know, every day we all make complicated trade-off decisions, choosing about different alternatives that we could select. For me, the most recent one in my family was my daughter had to choose a college, right? You may have had to pick a car, right? In making those decisions, we all identify certain factors or criteria that are important to our decision. You know, for a car, it may be safety, fuel economy, style, the stereo system, right? These are all factors. So we compare the various alternatives, how well they do on each of these factors, and yet we don't weight all of those factors exactly the same when we make our decisions. For some people, fuel economy will be more important. For others, safety will be more important. Right? As individuals, when we make private decisions, the identification of the weight to be provided for each of those factors, that's a private decision, and it should be. When a business is making a decision about what kind of chemical or process to use in the development of their consumer product, in the past, that has been viewed as purely a private decision. And for the business, that may be appropriate. But under AB 1879, it's no longer just a private decision. And the weights that we may accord to economic impact versus functionality versus human health, those are judgments that need to be made transparently. They need to be made consistently across all similarly situated cases. And they need to be made according to a set of criteria and weights accorded to those criteria that reflect the overall public good. The way the regulations are drafted right now, and this gets to my underlying, I guess you might say, broader concern about the regulations beyond just the function, is that this notion of the regulation as a reflection of the public good rather than simply private decision making is lost. And the weights that may be applied, the judgments that are made about which alternatives will be considered at all, let alone compared with the priority product, those are lost in the veil of the work that's done within a company. So if the regulations, so how do you solve this dilemma? How do you balance allowing companies to engage in a meaningful and appropriate and proportionate and flexible alternatives analysis, yet also ensure that the public aspect of regulation has an important and frankly central role to play in that decision making? I think the way that needs to be done is by identifying clear substantive decision rules that will be followed in the alternatives analysis. Decision rules that are flexible, yes, that have been subject to public input, yes, that are applied in every similarly situated case so that we ensure consistency across treatment, yes. Those types of substantive decision rules should be identified in the regulations themselves. Because the alternatives evaluation is so value-laden, the decision-making process needs to be directed by clearly articulated program expectations and specific decision rules. Examples of such decision frameworks can be found in various regulatory programs that are already on the books. For example, the Significant New Alternatives Program at the federal level that's designed to verify the safety of substitutes to ozone-depleting compounds. And the Superfund program regarding the selection of remedial alternatives at contaminated waste sites. Both of these programs have a fairly well-articulated set of narrative decision rules and program expectations. Now, I'm not suggesting that the Superfund program is the model that should be used. Clearly, that has significant deficiencies. So my reference to it isn't a general endorsement of the outcomes in that particular program. But those programs, SNAP and the Superfund program and others, represent well-developed examples of decision frameworks that can be used. They use a balancing of narrative-weighted criteria, and this could be adopted in the alternatives analysis process as well. The nature and scope of the decision rules that ought to be situated in the regulations should be an direct extension of the social values that underlie them. The regulation, for example, could specifically identify that the alternatives analysis variables, some carry more weight than others. For example, reduction of toxics might be viewed as generally more important than energy impacts. Or we may identify relative rankings within specific concerns. For example, it may be that we view skin irritation as less weighty than reproductive toxicity. I'm not trying to make those value choices today, but I offer them as examples of the kinds of decision rules, the kinds of judgments that need to be explicit in the regulation underlying guidance. Otherwise, those individual decisions, which is more important to the population generally, will be made by individual companies. The more specific the program goals, the more specific the decision rules, the more guided DTSC will be in determining the overall viability of alternatives relative to the baseline product. Now, I have laid out today three specific areas of concern. There are many more that exist in the regulation, very specific comments, which I'll share separately with DTSC. But I just, as I looked at the regulations and I thought about what are the types of core issues that may be relevant to oversight of the program and also relevant to the continuing role of the legislature in this area, I think that these three areas, information authority, resource constraints, And also a clear emphasis on consistent, clearly stated, but flexible decision rules were the most important issues that I could raise with you today. And I very much appreciate the opportunity to provide you with my thoughts on those issues. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor. Yes,
Vice Chair. I'll be brief. I think it can be answered pretty quick. I just want to just confirm your comment about the fee-based program, you articulated very well. We don't really know what those fees could be. They'd be tens of thousands of dollars. I want to make sure that what you're advocating or your belief is that the fee-based program would be in addition to the costs of the alternatives assessment. And then thirdly, is there any estimate on what the cost of the program is?
Yeah,
from your perspective.
Those are very good questions. I'll try to kind of address all of them. Yes, the fee-based program of which I'm discussing would be to cover the costs of DTSC in implementing the program, that is, engaging the prioritization, reviewing alternatives analysis, issuing regulatory responses. So that is an additional cost that's imposed by the program beyond the private costs that individual companies would incur as part of performing those alternative analyses. And of course, it is likely that in most cases, those additional costs from the fee-based program, I mean, to be honest about it, will be passed along to the ultimate consumer. Never a palatable prospect when you're talking about regulatory design. And yet, if we don't implement such a program, I mean, two things will happen. One, I think, is that AB 1879 itself will fall far short of its potential. But number two is we will continue to pay the costs of not engaging in a comprehensive program. Those will be the costs of the continued use of chemicals and the public health impacts that have on the broader population. With respect to the logistics of such a program, you raise an excellent point, which is much of the work of DTSC will be front-loaded through the prioritization process and also for these few, three or four perhaps, alternatives analyses that will be done. So there will be a fair amount of expense associated with that program, and yet we don't know right now, nor will we likely know until we get through that first segment, what the full cost of the program would be. So how would you implement such a program, such a fee-based program? And there's a couple of examples. There's been other permitting programs that face that similar problem. And with respect to those, what they did was they front-load they draw from other resources the cost of the early part of the program. And then later on in the program, when the fees are developed, they take into account those additional costs, and that gets kind of spread out across the program at large. It may be that what will be required for a fee-based program is to bring it out in stages. So it may be that the parties who are involved in the prioritization, so the 3,000 chemicals, the manufacturers and users of those 3,000 chemicals, may be required to pay a small fee associated with the cost of the prioritization program, that portion of the permitting program that involved in prioritization. And then when we get to the alternatives analysis, that part of the program is rolled out, there would be a separate fee schedule that deals with just those entities that are required to do alternatives analysis. And in a sense, that's the kind of proportionality and fairness that I'm talking about, which is you would not want necessarily to layer on folks who are not required to do alternatives analysis the cost of supporting the aspect of the permitting program that dealt with alternatives analysis.
But you can't definitively say today it's going to be $10 million, $30 million. There's no dollar amount.
As far as I know.
Assessed with that cost of the program.
I asked that actual question at the last Green Ribbon Science panel as I was kind of thinking about this fee-based. And the answer that I received from DTSC is that, you know, they don't know yet because, number one, they don't even know what the program will look like. But even when you know what the program will look like, it's going to take a little time to figure out what the population would be.
Thank you, Mr. Molloy.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. Next, I'm running behind on my scheduling here. Dr. Destin.
Thank you. I'm George Dastin. I'm a toxicologist and molecular biologist with Procter & Gamble. I have oversight of our human and environmental safety research programs and over how we approach the question of chemical safety. I wanted to start by thanking you for allowing me to participate in this and to participate in the Green Ribbon Science Panel. I always learn a lot from these processes and from my colleagues, so it's a great opportunity for me. I also wanted to start out by acknowledging the good work that Debbie Ruffell and her staff at DTSC have made in designing a program that I do think is pragmatic, doable, and most importantly makes a positive contribution to public and environmental health, which is what we're all here for. It's not to say it's perfect, but I'm really pleased with the progress, and I'll talk a little bit about that briefly. First, I wanted to start out with talking a little bit about Procter & Gamble and green chemistry. And I noticed that in the agenda for today that my official title of Victor Mills Society Research Fellow is how I'm identified. And Victor Mills is probably not a household name outside of Procter & Gamble, but he happened to be one of the most prolific inventors that P&G has had in the 1940s, 50s, and 60s. We know him as the inventor of the first practical disposable diaper. But the reason that I bring that up is that period of time and ongoing was a period of tremendous innovation for our company, and I think probably all of industry, as we had more opportunities through advances in chemistry and manufacturing and various things to actually design more and different products that we hope actually improve people's lives. But as we engaged in this increasing level of innovation, you know, we realized that with that comes the responsibility to understand the good and the bad aspects of that innovation. So we at Procter & Gamble have had a formal safety organization for more than 50 years now. And we've been involved, that organization has been involved in what we're now calling green chemistry and alternatives assessment for that period of time. Throughout that, we consider safety to be paramount, and so we do have criteria for what we consider to be safe, and we don't compromise on those. So both Debbie and Meg in their comments talked about something called nonyl phenol ethoxylate, which is an ingredient in detergents, and we at P&G have determined and did so probably back in the 1960s, that we would not use that material because of its poor environmental toxicity and environmental fate parameters. And we made this decision really regardless of cost. It turns out that it's probably the cheapest surfactant out there and is very effective. So even though this put us at a cost disadvantage, we felt that it was not the appropriate material to use. So, you know, we're very glad to see these kinds of considerations being made a lot more generalized through these kinds of regulations. And safety happens to be a part of the design considerations for our new ingredients. So we actually have safety up front in any sort of innovation work that we do. We will design materials with safety in mind, such as designing detergent ingredients that break down quickly once they're added to water so that there is no environmental burden. So we know a lot about alternatives assessment. And really what our view of alternatives assessment is safety is first. Safety is the most important parameter. But beyond that, there are a series of other considerations which have been nicely codified in AB 1879 that need to be considered in terms of not just equivalent or better product performance, but things that will wax and wane in terms of their importance based on not only what the product is, but you know what the context is. So things like energy use have become, or greenhouse gas emission, have become much more important than they would have been, 20, 30 years ago. And those are the kinds of things that we weigh. The ultimate goal is to make improvements in one parameter while not having any compromises on the others. That's easier said than done. And what we find is that these things are complex, such that when one makes a change in an ingredient, often it will result in some decrements in some of the parameters that we're measuring and some improvements in others. And then, you know, really is the complexity comes in understanding whether those decrements are sufficiently bad that they outweigh outweigh the good parts of improving other parameters. So, you know, one might example that a big win in energy use might come with a small decrement in the time it takes for something to degrade in the environment. And it really takes a great deal of expertise to understand whether that decrement is really significant. You know, if it's a half an hour, it probably isn't. If it's, you know, 4 months, it probably is. And those are the kinds of things that we have to understand with great detail. And we have to have the expertise in toto, and probably doesn't reside in one person, to weigh. And the reason that I bring up these kinds of examples is to note the need for flexibility. And I'm really heartened that as we've moved forward in putting together these informal regs, that flexibility has been included in the alternatives process. I think that has to be accompanied by a number of factors that particularly Professor Malloy has brought up. And among these are transparency, such that the process can be followed, such that everyone can understand that even though it's flexible, that all of the important factors have been considered. Scientific rigor and robustness have to be part of the process. And if it's transparent, I think that people will see that it is. And consistency. But flexibility, I think, is the thing that we want to make sure that we preserve. I think Tim brought up, this important consideration of the importance of understanding the various affected criteria with considerable depth. There's so many moving parts when you've got 13 different criteria writ large that you're trying to evaluate. We would all agree that it's appropriate to weight some criteria more than others. And I think that we've all, come to the conclusion that safety is the first one that we want to evaluate. But assuming that safety concerns are equivalent for various alternatives and low, the weighting for the other parameters, I think, is going to be an important value judgment. And I think that that's where I certainly agree with Tim in terms of the need for consistency and the need for the opportunity for continued stakeholder participation and weighing in on these kinds of processes. I might disagree with the fact that we need some sort of very rigid process to ensure that each of the parameters is weighed. I think we need to do this on a case-by-case basis. But as long as we have an open process that is transparent and that does provide interested parties with the opportunity to participate, I think that it will be in a good place. One potential problem that I see with the informal regs as we move forward is the number of chemicals of concern that we have. The philosophy was to list a large number of chemicals, which is estimated at this point to be 3,000, for the purpose of preventing knee-jerk reactions. So a company seeing that their chemical was on the list of concern and moving to another one without regard that it might also pose concerns or even be worse. I do understand that, but I think it creates a few other problems. One is the problem is on how to list chemicals. I think when we start thinking about how to list chemicals as chemicals of concern, one needs to make sure that those chemicals have been evaluated by experts and that they understand and that they agree that something deserves to be on a list. And we do have a variety of authoritative bodies that have made lists. I think we're all familiar with Proposition 65, and there are others. And DTSC has done a good job of compiling those. On the other hand, there are lists that have been made that are far from authoritative, and I think that it's very important that we'd be very careful in how we evaluate those things. OEHA has come up with a list of hazard traits, as they were asked to do. My concern with the hazard traits that they've developed is that they're overly generic and don't provide enough guidance to allow for well-informed decision-making about what to list in the absence of authoritative bodies that list things like cardiovascular toxicants and immunotoxicants and what have you. So there's a need, I think, to provide a great deal more guidance. And it's probably not just sufficient to give guidance about whether a substance is or is not an immunotoxicant, say. But it's also important to give guidance as to under what context, at what dosage, at what exposure levels. Because we're not going to be doing anybody any favors if we move from one chemical to another only to find that one uses 10 times as much as of the other one to get the similar product benefit, and therefore the exposure would exceed a level such that the alternative chemical is worse than the first in use. I guess the point is that while some chemicals may very well be unsafe at any speed, most of them are not. And if we had a list of 3,000, I think we could find circumstances under which chemicals can be used safely and circumstances and contexts in which they can't. And I think that we need that level of granularity. The good thing about that is OEHA has some of the best toxicologists and risk assessors in the world. And so they're up to the task. I think we need to ask more from them. The other problem that I have